harvest, let's stand together and sing today.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my head lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. The battle belongs to you. Yes. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. No mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I'm really glad you took time to join us today. My name is Dave Learned. I serve as the co-campus pastor at our Rolling Meadows campus. And hey, as we're getting started today, we would love to know where you're watching from today. We have people join us from all over the country and frankly, all over the world sometimes. So just be fun to hear from you with a chat, a note in the chat or in the comments. If this is your first time with us, I want to give you a very special welcome. You could be doing a lot of different things with your time, but today you're with us for worship, and we're really glad you joined us today. Maybe it's your first time, maybe you're here every week. For all of us, I want to invite you to check in. You can do that right here on this page. There's a link in the comments, or you can go to the Harvest Bible Chapel app. Either way, we'd love to know that you're with us, and particularly, we'd love to pray for you. So if there's a prayer request, please let us know that as well. It's a perfect day to join us for worship because this is actually week 2 of our 3-week series, Yes, I Will. Pastor Eddie Hoagland is going to be preaching today, and I just want to encourage you to get a copy of God's Word open in front of you because it's His Word that we need to hear from, and I believe He's got a word for you and I both today. Hey, one of the things that's happening on our Rolling Meadows campus is a new class. It's called How to Study the Bible Seriously. That sounds kind of serious, doesn't it? Well, what it is a very practical, personal class on how to study God's Word for yourself. It's taught by Dr. Michael Van Lanningham, one of our pastors. And in this, you're going to learn a foundational way that you can study God's Word for yourself. So for any adult, this is perfect. Class actually started last Wednesday, but it's not too late. You can jump in. It's meeting in person on the Rolling Meadows campus. And if you're interested, you can get all the information at harvestnow.info. We love that there's so many kids in our church. Maybe some of them are listening right now. Hey kids, hope you're doing great. If you've got preschool or grade school kids, I just want to take a moment to remind you that we have fresh, fun, biblical content available every week on Harvest Kids at Home. You can check it out on the link right here on this page or go to harvestnow.info. One of the things we say a lot in our church is that Harvest is not just a church with some small groups, but we're a church of small groups. Small groups are honestly the heartbeat of our church. It's where people connect. It's where you have community. It's a place where your relationship with the Lord can grow and your relationship with others. And I'll tell you what, this is a time in our world when we need that. There's just no part of Scripture that says that the Christian life should be alone. It needs to be together in community. So January, start of a new year, great time to connect in a small group. All the details are at harvestnow.info. Well, we are super thankful for the generous people in our church. The Lord is faithful. He's meeting the needs. He's advancing His purpose in our church. I want you to know there's 4 different ways to give if that's something you want to do today. Giving is an act of the Lord, an act of worship to the Lord. And so you can do it right here on this page. There's a link there. You can go through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. There's a way to text in a gift, or you could put it in the mail. But kind of exciting, there's a new way this week. There's a 5th way that you can give. If you grab your camera on your phone and hold it up, see that QR code? Right there, it'll take you directly to the page where you can give an offering through the website. Thanks for being a part of worship through giving today. Well, as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, I want to recognize that this is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And so we just want to get God's perspective on life, and I want to read these verses. So this is from Psalm 139, starting in verse 13. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, we just thank you that you are so clearly and so perfectly the author of life. It is an unbelievable concept that you knit us together. We worship you and serve you as the creator that you are. Lord, we ask that you would help us to uphold the value, the treasure of human life in every opportunity we have. Lord, we thank you now for this opportunity to worship you, to praise you, to hear from you through your word. Would you speak to us today, Lord? We don't want to check a box. We don't want to go through motions. We want to give you the worship and praise that you are due, and we need to hear from you. Speak to our hearts, we pray today in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, sing with me.
We want to give you pure exaltation. So open the heavens, receive what is yours, Jesus. Receive what is yours, worthy. Worthy are you, God. Worthy is your name. Worthy of our praise, we worship you. Here we stand in awe. You deserve it all, Jesus, evermore. We worship you.
Worthy is your name. Worthy.
worthy of our praise. We worship you. Here we stand in awe, for you deserve it all. Jesus, evermore, we will worship.
We're John and Suzanne Kilner, and we both grew up here on the North Shore. We went to Sunday school, we went to church, but we really had no sense of meaning. It wasn't until college that God brought us together with people who shared with us the fact that it's possible to actually know God personally. And so that really changed the way we view life. We knew that God had created us and had a purpose for us. So Suzanne went on to master's degree studies at Yale, and I went on to do a master's degree at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, and then a master's and PhD at Harvard University. And we ended up back here on the North Shore in 1991. It wasn't until 2012 that Suzanne and I actually became connected with Harvest. What a tremendous gift of God the fellowship has been to us. In August of 2017, that's when the bombshell dropped. I had my physical exam, normal annual physical exam, and there was one number in my blood that was a little off. And what they discovered was the very rare blood cancer that causes the blood to thicken, and the number was through the roof.
We were both in shock because he was otherwise very healthy and very strong. I tried very hard to get my heart to a place where I was willing, if God wanted to take him, for him to die. And I couldn't bring myself to that point and struggled with it a great deal.
What they explained was that it is an incurable cancer, but they've developed basically two approaches that can slow it down, starting with approach number one, which involved a chemotherapy, it involved a high-dose steroid, and it involved an infusion of monoclonal antibodies. When they did the first infusion, I started shivering, and then I started shaking, and then all of a sudden my blood pressure just started falling through the floor, and I was just rapidly heading into unconsciousness, and they had to call a code blue. Now, if you've watched TV, you know, you've seen these situations. The patient is on a gurney and they're racing down the hallway and there's like eight healthcare professionals gathered around. Well, that is exactly what it's like. It was a horrendous experience. It just, you know, shook me to the core. I was just like crying out in my mind and my heart and my soul to God to sustain me. And just experiencing, knowing that God was there with me, I just can't tell you what an amazing experience that was. So in October, we started the only other major avenue available. And what that constitutes is a $500 pill that I have to take every day. So yes, that's been an expensive situation, but you know what? God has provided miraculously. And the impact was amazing. I mean, by December of 2018, just a couple of months later, the IgM numbers absolutely plummeted. And in December of 2020, they went down so much that they were approaching the level of normal range for IgM, which is just absolutely amazing.
One of my life verses that has helped me through many things is from 2 Corinthians. My grace is sufficient in you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness.
My whole life has been trying to be strong, trying to be good, trying to achieve, and I need strength and ability in order to do that. And here's this undermining and sapping my strength, but what the Apostle Paul learned was God demonstrates his strength precisely through our weakness. When I turn to God for the strength that I need, that's when I experience the power and, more importantly, the presence of God to be able to get through what is before me.
I now live our life assuming that John will live for, I hope, a long time, and that I can trust God that when the time comes for him to go to heaven, that then at that point God will give me grace to endure it. And I know that this kind of faith is a gift from God, and I am very grateful to have been given that gift.
I've come to the point where I can thank God. I can thank God for all that I've been through. These last several years have been the richest time in my life. in terms of personal experience of the goodness of God. And yes, it's been hard. Yes, it's been difficult. Yes, it's been challenging. But what could be better than to know Christ and for Christ to live his life in a way that's manifested to the world through you? Life doesn't get any better than that.
Great is the Lord God Almighty, worthy of honor and praise. And I stand in awe of his glory, and I stand in need of his grace. And hallelujah.
Let it be so, Lord. Let it be so. Thank you that in your presence is rest, in your presence is peace, in your presence is joy. Because when we come to you, Father, we come to the one who reigns. We come to the one who is able to do anything. And we come oftentimes with such meager expectations of what you want to do for us. But the truth is, we know because of the cross, there is no length that you wouldn't go. And there is nothing that you would not do for your people. We love you, Father. We thank you. Teach us now through your word, by your Holy Spirit. All God's people together said, amen. Amen. Do you have a seat, please, this morning?
Week two of our series, Yes, I Will. If you're ready for week two, say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
All right, all right. Well, then I'll preach the sermon. Here we go, week two. I got to start off by talking about maybe you have a friend or have had a friend who enjoys scaring people. You know what I'm talking about? Just like that super annoying guy who, like, every corner you turn, he's just crouched behind it. He's excited to be like, wah, and scare you. I may or may not be that guy, and I've had to learn some lessons in life. I remember one time I scared my dad because he had put us to bed, and all the lights were off in the house, and after he put us to bed, then he went downstairs to counsel a family that was in our church, and then I heard him open the front door to go out to say goodbye to those people he was spending time with, and I was like, here's my opportunity. So then I went downstairs, again, all the lights are off, I went into his office, which was right by the front door, and I found what can only be described as a divinely appointed moment, where I found a full chicken mask in my dad's office. Now, I don't know where that mask came from, and I don't know where it went after this moment, but it was just there, and I was like, yes, thank you, Lord, you know? So I put on this chicken mask, and so my dad, you know, he says goodbye to those people. He comes into a house with absolutely no lights on, and he comes in, and I just jump out, and I'm like, bah! You know, like, and my dad was ready to defend his household. I will say that. He was not calm, and again, I've never seen that mask since, but it also reminded me of how, even just a couple years ago, I found this video on my phone from a couple years ago of me scaring Kyle and Lauren, who, you know, they lead worship here at the Rolling Meadows campus, and we were at the Chick-fil-A here in Schaumburg, and check this out. So I just came up to their car to greet them, and this is what I got.
Hey! Oh my.
I'm sorry, that's just too good. Just play it again. I just need to enjoy this one more time. Go ahead. The approach, the yell.
Hey! Oh my.
And if you couldn't hear what Kyle was saying, he's like, I'm sorry. He feels bad that he hit my phone after I scared him. What a nice guy. He's just such a nice guy. So I've always been that person, but then I got married, okay? And you find out that certain things just aren't allowed in marriage. And I found out pretty quickly as a newlywed, this would be a no-go, okay? In marriage, Christina's not having it when it comes to me scaring her. So I've learned, I've grown, and I've learned. But honestly, those are just stories of someone getting surprised or shocked in the moment, caught off guard, right? But today I want to talk to you about something a lot more serious, and that is fear. Fear is a very real topic. It is something that can really affect you and me. Fear is a real problem in our lives, and it's not just that short burst or that short moment like you saw in that video. It's a weighty thing. and you walked into this room today, and you have that weight on your heart. So even if you carry yourself as someone who, you know, kind of looks like they are anxious about life, or even if you try to be that person who's tough as nails, you know, I can handle anything, the reality is we all face fear, okay? We all have to deal with this real problem that is fear. But I'm convinced of better things for you today. We're going to jump back into Psalm 23, finish that verse, verse 4. Psalm 23. Let's read it together today. Would you stand in honor of God's word across all our campuses? Let's stand. We're going to read Psalm 23, starting in verse 1 and going through to verse 4. Let's read together. Psalm 23 says this: "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Let's pray together. Father, this is your word that we're studying, and we want to receive it as your people. We're ready to listen, we're ready to learn, and we're ready to receive whatever you would have for us today. May it be so. In the name of Jesus, we pray, all God's people said, amen. Amen. You can take a seat. Well, last week we talked about walking through the valley, and how that means that you're not running. It also means that you're not stopped in the valley. And this week we're talking about one of the main things that will stop you in the valley, and that's fear. So week two of our series is titled, "I Will Fear No Evil." I will fear no evil. Let's jump right in. Point one is that. It's fear no evil. Fear no evil. Now, I got to start by talking about the fact that not all fear is bad, right? There's some fear that is healthy. First category of fear that I would say is not bad, I'm just going to label it this way. Let's call it natural fear. So this is the fear you have if someone were to break into your house and then you grab a bat and you go confront them. You're going to be filled with fear. But that fear is going to trigger your ability, that fight or flight, right? Like, I'm afraid, but I'm activated to protect my house. And that's a good fear. That's a natural fear. It's the same fear maybe some of us had on the way over here to church. If you were driving on I-90 and you're like, man, this isn't great. This isn't, there's quite a bit of snow and people are passing me going 90 miles an hour. I just feel like this is, I gotta pay more attention, right, as I drive. That's a natural fear. It's not a crippling fear. It just puts you on alert for a moment, and that's healthy. There's also the fear of the Lord. That's also a good fear. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What that means is, as we get to see God and we get to know him, you see how great he is and how awesome he is in power. And then you quickly realize that he's also a perfect God. He's a holy God. And that powerful God has holy justice. And we quickly enter into fear because we're like, yeah, we're going to be receiving that judgment from God. But as you get to know God, you realize that he not only has holy justice, but he also has holy love for you. It's both those things, justice and mercy, judgment and love. God is both those things. And so it's the beginning of wisdom, of understanding God, is going to start with the fear of the Lord, which is a good thing to give him his proper place as sovereign Lord of all. But here we're talking about the fear of evil. The fear of evil. The fear of what could happen in my life, the evil things that could fall on my life. And it's different than natural fear, because natural fear is an instance. It happens in the moment. It's how you respond to a situation. But fear of evil, it sits on your heart. It takes residence in your heart. And it starts setting roots and taking roots in your heart, and that will lead you to make some very wrong decisions in life. And it will stop you in your tracks in the valley. That's the fear we're talking about today, the fear that stays, the fear that doesn't leave after a moment. But God is going to answer your fear. God's going to be the answer to your fear. And so I want to share with you four common fears. I could have picked a bunch of them, I'm sure, but here's the four that were on my heart to share with you today. First, the fear of death. The fear of death. Again, not the natural fear of death, which is healthy. There's that moment of, I'm in danger. I don't want to die in this moment, so I'm going to do something to guard myself, to protect myself. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the fear of death as in, I think about it all the time. I can't stop thinking about it. I'm so anxious about the fact that when I die, it's going to radically change the lives of those around me. And that's all true. But here's the thing. Here's God's answer to the fear of death. God says that death is defeated. This is big news. Death itself is defeated. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is where we find that famous passage that says, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. There is now victory over death through Jesus Christ. That's God's answer to that fear of, I can't stop thinking about it. Well, hear this today. Death is defeated. What does that mean? Does that mean we're not going to die through Jesus Christ? No, there's still the earthly death, but death has lost its sting. It doesn't have its power anymore, because for the child of God, death does not mean eternity in judgment. For the child of God, death means eternity with God. Eternal life. You don't have to fear that. It's swallowed up in victory. It does not have the final word in your life anymore through the work of Jesus Christ. So God's response to the fear of death is that death is defeated. Second fear, the fear of the future. This covers a whole lot of things. The fear of the future, the fear of the unknown, right? Is it always going to be this way? Am I always going to have a job? Am I always going to be able to pay my bills? Am I always going to be single? Is it always going to be this difficult? All those fears about the future. What does the future hold? Well, God doesn't print out some list and say, here's exactly what's going to happen in your life. But here's the good news. God says that your future is good. The future you have before you is good. We studied Romans 8:28 already last year, and it says that God is working together all things for good. Isn't that amazing? All the things that are happening in your life, the good, the bad, God is working all those things together, and what he's telling you today is that what is ahead is something good. It doesn't mean that it won't be difficult. It doesn't mean that there's no pain in your future here on earth. It just means the plan he has is good. There's going to be a day where you enter into the future and you're going to look back and say, it was good. God was good. And his response to my fear of the future is to let me know that the future is good. Third fear, the fear of failure. Maybe you were like me, and in college I would fill out applications for jobs, and sometimes they would ask me, what's your greatest fear? And I would always jot down that. I would say the fear of failure. And it's because, if you know me, I'm a bit of a achiever, a driven person, and so I don't want to do things that don't succeed. And that can be crippling at times, because you don't want it to fail, so you might not do it at all. And that's where fear starts taking root, the fear of failure. And God's response to that is that he remains faithful. Man, this is a game changer when it comes to God speaking into your life. If you can see what he does for you is that he remains faithful no matter what, no matter what you do. He's still going to be faithful. Proverbs 16:9 says, the heart of man plans his way. That's your job. That's my job. The heart of man plans his way, but then listen to this, but the Lord establishes his steps. Isn't that amazing? What God is saying, look, you get to make a plan. You get to go down life in a direction. You got to make some decisions, but you don't have to freak out and be afraid of failing, because I'm going to remain faithful. I will personally establish your steps. That is a good place to be. And that's what's going to get rid of that fear of failure. Last common fear is the fear of insignificance. the fear that all this stuff that I'm doing, it's just not making a difference. And this is why you see people who, you know, they could be in a career for decades, and then suddenly it's like, boom, they're out. I quit, I'm starting over, I'm doing this. Why? What's behind that? A lot of times it's this. It's the fear of insignificance, that I want to give my life to something that's worth giving it to. And you can struggle with that fear of insignificance, or maybe you're full-time at home and your job is to raise these children, and you feel like, well, they're not thanking me. Is this making a difference? Am I being significant in the lives of others? Well, here's God's invitation for you, is that you get to work for him. You get to work for God himself. It doesn't matter what job you have. You understand that. Working for the Lord does not mean working at a church. Working for the Lord is the calling on every believer, that you get to work for God. He's your boss, okay? Your boss is not actually your boss. He's your little boss. You have a real boss, an awesome boss, and that is Jesus Christ. And he has set you on a mission in whatever place he placed you. That's where you're supposed to be a missionary there and work for him. And in the home, if you're raising their children, this is what changes in your mind. You are raising those kids for the Lord. You are on mission for him, and that gives you significance in life. 1 Corinthians 15:58 ends the chapter by saying this: therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord, your labor is not in vain. It's not in vain. So the decade you spent in that one career field, if you worked for the Lord during those years, it wasn't in vain. Doesn't matter where it ends. Doesn't matter how far up that ladder you got. And if you faithfully serve the Lord, raising those children at home, but you do it for the Lord, listen, your work for the Lord was not in vain. No matter what comes in the future, if you fear insignificance, focus on working for the Lord. See, look at that list of stuff. Look at all the things that we have to experience in this broken, fallen world. Those fears, and like I said, that list could be longer, but I just love how what man meant for evil, God can use for good. He has a response to the things that we face. And that's why I will fear no evil. Why I will fear no evil is found in what God says himself. And I have to remind myself of this constantly. It's not like I'm teaching you about fear and here are the responses. It's like, okay, great, I learned it on Sunday, I'm good to go. No, it's not like that. It is a fight. You have to fight for this. You have to hold on to what God says over and over again. This is why the psalmist says, notice, I will fear no evil. I will fear no evil. He's making the declaration today, then he's knowing the fight is coming up tomorrow and the day after that. I will, as I walk into the future, I will not fear evil. I'm not going to do it. How? Point two, God is with you. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, for you are with me. That word for is a really important word. For God is with me, for you are with me. The reason part two is significant is because it enables part one. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. That's how I can do this. It's because God is with me. Look, I've been waiting since the beginning of the series up until this point to really share this truth with you, and it kind of leaked out as I taught the first week because I'm so excited to tell you this. I've been talking about valleys. I've been talking about fear, but hear the good news today. God is with you. That is big news. God is with you. Such an amazing thing. We can't spend too much time on this because all the fake gods that are out there, they're just some sort of, I don't know, some sort of heavenly being that's up in the sky and they're all upset at us as earthlings, and we got to do all this crazy stuff to keep them happy so that we can find their favor and they can give us nice stuff. That's all the fake gods, and all that is not real. But listen, the one true God wants you to hear today that he is with you. He is with you. No matter what you're walking through, he's with you. It's just like in our most loving relationships, where we go through loss, we go through great suffering, and It's so clear that when you love that person, even if you don't know what to say in the moment, you know what to do. You know you're supposed to do everything you can to be with that person, to be with that person in the valley. Reminds me of the book of Job, where his friends sat with him silently for 7 days because they knew that they should be with him because they loved him. And today I'm here to tell you that God is with you. God is with you. Let me tell you a little bit about this God that is with you. I'm going to use two words to describe him to you. They both start with the letter I: immensity and imminence. Let me talk to you about the immensity and imminence of God. God is truly awesome, and we'll never be able to describe him fully. That's how awesome he is. Let me talk to you about his immensity. So, you know, anybody like road trips? If you're that person who's like, sign me up, 12 hours in a car, yeah, that's great. That might be you. Okay, yeah, see, I would say my wife's that, but I'm not. I kind of tap out around 8 or 9 hours. I'm like, isn't there a plane that can do this better, you know? I've driven many, many road trips, and it's pretty amazing, though, what you get to do. You can hop in a car right now after church. You could drive 12 hours. Now look on that map, and look how far you could go in one day. I think that's pretty amazing how much distance we can cover. People used to have to walk places, okay? People used to have to ride horses to places, and here we are in our cars, and you can go from here to here all in one day. Now, that's just traveling on Earth. Then you have planes, and then after that, you have space travel. Now we're starting to really cross some great distances, and we know how far the sun is. That's the nearest star to us, And now, if we weren't tracking time by how many hours drive it is or how many hours spaceship flight it is, you would now enter into the new territory, which is calculating things by the speed of light. So the sun is 8.3 minutes away if you could travel at the speed of light. That's really far away, okay? Really far away, 8.3 minutes, and that's the nearest star. Now, look at all the stars that God has created. There's a lot of them out there. All right, and our nearest one is 8.3 minutes going at light speed to the sun. And I researched this week because I was like, I'm just curious, what is the farthest star that we know of? And I was able to find an article that talked about how we have recently seen an image of what would be considered today the furthest star from Earth, and it's called Max J1149. Isn't that romantic? You know some husband bought that for his wife, right? Like, I named it for you. It's called Max J1149. Love you, baby. So there it is. Get this. It's nine, what word do you think I'm gonna say? So remember, 8.3 minutes to the sun. After minutes, you got hours, days, months, years, tens thousand years, hundred thousands of years, millions, 9 billion light years away. I don't understand that. You don't understand that. If you do, you're wrong. You do not understand what 9 billion years, that is super, super far away. And then I also found out that the only reason we could even see it is some crazy thing happened where like a cluster of galaxies formed in such a way that they created a lens for us to be able to see this star behind it. What? Like, again, blown away by what we can do today. That is really, really far away. And all of this exists because God spoke. Isn't that amazing? God spoke. That is a God of great immensity. But that God of great immensity is also imminent. Same God. Same great God. He's also near. You know the verse, James chapter 4, verse 8, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Or you might say it the way the psalmist says it. He says, the nearness of my God is good. It's good for me. It's my good. What an amazing thing that the God who spoke and all that we see now exists because of him, that same God is near to you. That same God is with you. And just in the same way as your mind cannot understand how great he is, I believe that your mind cannot understand how near he is today. You can't. It's impossible to comprehend that God is with you. Because God could have said that he's everywhere in the valley, right? Because he is. God is everywhere. God's omnipresent. He's everywhere inside of that valley, but do you hear his voice? Do you hear what he's trying to tell you today? Even though he's everywhere in the valley, God wants you to hear that he's with you. That he's with you. Fear no evil. God is with you. And God will comfort you. God will comfort you. The last part of this verse says that God's rod and his staff comfort me. It's a picture pulled directly from a shepherd, what the shepherd would have. So let's study what those are and how they would comfort you today. Well, let's start with the rod. The rod is a thick wooden pole. It's just a stick. That's all it is, nothing special. And interestingly enough, it was also a symbol. It wasn't just a tool, it also was a symbol. It was a symbol of authority, and then it was used for two things. This symbol of authority was used for two things, to count the sheep and to protect the sheep. And at first, I thought it would be to discipline the sheep, but again, we're talking about comforting the sheep. So that's not specifically to this picture with the rod. He's counting the sheep and protecting the sheep, and that's why it's their comfort. So this symbol of authority, the rod, how does that comfort us? Well, first, you find comfort in the authority of God. It's a symbol of authority. You can find comfort in the authority of God. Here's how. Do you understand that no matter what you're going through, there's nothing you could possibly walk through that's outside of the jurisdiction of God's authority? It's all under him. This is what it means that he is sovereign Lord over everything. And you should find comfort today in the fact that God has that authority. I'm comforted by that. I also find comfort in the fact that with his rod, he counts us. That means God's mindful of you. Be comforted today by knowing that God counts you. God sees you. It's like the psalmist said, who am I that you would think of me, that you are mindful of me? It's such an amazing truth. Be comforted today in knowing that God is mindful of you. And then find comfort in God's protection. It's comforting to know that God is the one who's protecting me, because if it was my job to protect you, I'd be nervous about that. I have limited capacity, limited strength, limited abilities. That's not ever an issue for God. God doesn't have those limitations, and he's the one protecting you. So find comfort in his authority. Find comfort that he's mindful of you. Find comfort in his protection. And then it's not just the rod, but it's also the staff. And the staff is that longer pole, the one we typically think of with a shepherd. It tends to have a curved end for the purpose of being able to guide the sheep more effectively, because if needed, they could reach down with the staff, and with that hook, they could even grab the neck of the sheep and start guiding and start pulling left or right if necessary. And that's comforting. That's good news for us. You can find comfort in the fact that God will guide you. God's going to guide you. He's not just going to say, go for it, figure it out. No, he's going to guide you. He is with you. And that's comforting. And he will guide you with that point of contact with his staff. I love that his staff comforts us, because that tells you that he's near enough to you that his staff can reach you. He's not so far that his staff can't reach you. He's always going to be near enough to have that point of contact. Because sheep, as sheep, we look down. Have you ever seen a sheep walking in a field and they're like assessing the situation? Rarely, right? They're just looking down, eating some grass, just moving forward. And so sheep look down often, and many times they don't see the shepherd, but I love that when they're going the wrong way, they can feel that staff guide them. They can have that point of contact. Have you ever been comforted by that point of contact with God? You know what I'm talking about, where you pray something in the morning. You bring to God your requests. And then halfway through the day, something happens where someone just says something, and it's not necessarily like the answer to the prayer, but it's just you can sense that God's saying, I see you, right? That there's it's too way far beyond coincidence that someone just walked up to me and said that. Those are point of contact. God is saying, I'm guiding you. Keep praying, keep spending time with me because I am with you. And that is a point of comfort. It reminds me of a few years ago where I had just a really rough day, okay? Not a bad hair day, no, like way worse than that. Like a really, really rough day. And I remember because I was in this meeting that, you know, if it was 30 minutes, I would have been fine with 30 minutes, but it wasn't an hour, it wasn't 2 hours. It was a 7-hour meeting, and it was really, really difficult. And I remember feeling physically depleted. I could feel my blood sugar drop. I had to eat something because it was not just the physical cost, it was the emotional cost of what was happening that day. And I remember leaving that meeting and then walking down to my office and sitting down, and you know the feeling where it's just like, whoa, like that's it. That's everything I had for today. And I remember so clearly, I remember Andy, you know, Andy Rozier, one of our worship pastors, his office is right next to mine. And he got up out of his office, came over to mine. And I was sitting there, he walked in, and he looked at me and he said, Eddie, you don't have to tell me anything. I just want to pray for you right now. And so the way my office is set up, you kind of have to walk around my desk to actually even get to me. And so he did that. He walks around. He comes up behind me. And he put his hand on my shoulder. And then he prayed for me. And his prayer was very encouraging. His prayer was very comforting. But can I just tell you, just the moment he put his hand on my shoulder, I received comfort. Because Andy was saying, I'm with you. I'm with you, Eddie. And that point of contact was the way he was expressing that. And so if you're facing fear today, you need to have that moment with God where you could leave knowing that he's with you. Not just here, but here. God is with you. I've asked the Lord this week to comfort his people. That today would be a day to receive the ministry of the Lord. A day to sense that he is with you. And instead of a closing song where we sing something about fear, I wanted to create a space for God to minister to his sheep. A space for the shepherd to comfort his sheep. Where you would get to spend a few minutes without distractions and just be in the presence of your shepherd. Has fear got in the way of your path through the valley? Is it hard to keep walking because you kind of feel like your legs are shaking? You don't have to fear the evil, the pain, the suffering that might fall on your life because your shepherd is with you. And he's ready right now to comfort you. We're going to spend the next few moments focusing on this, worshiping the Lord. And if you're able and willing, I'm going to invite you to kneel. Kneeling in many contexts of the evangelical church has been a de-emphasized posture for many reasons, I'm sure. But it is a biblical response. Psalm 95:6 says this, "Oh, come." Do you hear the invitation? Come. Let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. He knows you. He made you. He's your Maker. So kneel to get low before the Lord. Kneel to acknowledge your weakness. And kneel to acknowledge your need. kneel to acknowledge your fear. So across all our campuses, because of the times that we're in, there actually is space in your row to just kneel right in front of your seat. And if you're an Elgin, you might have a row and you may or may not be able to kneel there, but you're welcome to use the aisle if you need. If you physically can and your spirit is willing, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
Dark, and it's hard to see what you are doing here in the ruins and where this will lead. Oh, but I know that down through the see your hand on it and know you were here. And I'll testify of the battles you've won, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough. And I'll testify of the seas that we've crossed, the waters you've parted, and the waves that I've walked, singing. You're the God who comes through. Oh, but I know that over the years, I'll look back on this moment and see a hand on and know you were of the back. when there wasn't enough. Thank you, Jesus. And I'll sing the song of the seas that we've crossed. The waters you've parted, the waves that I've walked. Oh, my God, did not fail. You are faithful, God. Oh, it's the story I'll tell. I'll sing of your goodness. Oh, my soul, it is well. Oh, it's the story I'll tell.
Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. He is good. Father, your nearness is good for us. What has just happened is good for us. We get low before you because you are the great God. You are the one we want to see as great. That you would be magnified in this place, that our perspective would change of you. Lord, you see your sheep. And you care for them as they need. And you protect them as they need. And you guide them as you need. So today, God, we pray against fear. Would you release us of that fear that's rooted in our hearts? That there would be breakthrough right now as we spend time with you. Let this fear leave us. That we would get to walk with the confidence that David says in Psalm 23, that I will not fear evil. We declare that in this place, and then God, we're going to walk in that truth. And every time we face it, every time we feel it in our hearts again, we're going to remind ourselves that you are with us. That God, you're with us no matter where we're going to go, no matter what we're walking through, you're still with us. Thank you, God. Thank you that you're with us, and you did not give us a spirit of fear. You did not do that. You gave us a spirit of power and of love and of self-control, of a sound mind. God, we need that. We need to be thinking correctly of the things that you have said. God, we need that sound mind. So as we leave today, would you do that? Would you give us the right thoughts so that we walk out of here in confidence, not in ourselves, but with the confidence we have in you, that you are with us, that your rod and your staff, they will comfort us when we need it. Thank you, Lord. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Now, anything that you have received, anything that you just received, receive it with thanks. Thanks to the Lord for meeting you here. I will walk through the valley. I will fear no evil. And next week we're going to be closing our series, and you're really not going to want to miss this one, okay? It's going to be a little bit of a party. So I hope to see you next week. But until then, hear these words. You are loved.